Work session of the City Commission of Bowling Green, please come to order. Item number one, Mr. City Manager.
If you remember, some time ago, the commission made a decision for us to start managing the three parks, that being Circus Square, Fountain Square, Riverside Park, and to manage the rentals there. We have since been doing that, I think, over the last month. During that period of pendency, I received an email, I think, from one of the commissioners, maybe Moore, about some complaints they received about how the place had been rented previously. This is no indictment of anyone. So we looked at the protocol, the insurance protocol, and we're here tonight to ask you to consider some recommendations that we staff have to ease the rental of the three properties. Bobby Joe, as you know, is the person responsible for managing these three facilities and running them out. We worked as a team and put together some requirements. She'll go through all these, but it should be noted that it's designed to make it easier for people to rent a facility. Because DRA was formerly a private standalone organization, they used an a la carte or menu system. If you did this, you paid extra for that because they didn't have staff. They had no staff to do the work, providing some of the services. So we understand why they had that structure. We've come back and basically put together a simpler rental structure and have looked at the insurance requirement and think we have some logic behind that and have even gone out so far as to find reasonable insurance available for various nonprofit groups who heretofore may not been able to find insurance. So we've tried to take care of the insurance issue, tried to simplify the fee structure, and essentially hope to provide this at less cost than it was formerly. Again, this is no indictment of DRA. They were standalone. They had to cover their cost. We're a city government. We have a little more length and breadth to our organization, so we feel we can do this. With your courtesy, Bobby Joe would like to make a presentation on these changes, and our hope is at the next commission meeting, if you find these acceptable, we'll do a municipal order to incorporate them.
Good afternoon. How is everybody?
Fine.
Good. Thank you for having me. As you can see with the memo that I provided and also with the proposed fee change, I have a description there of what the current fees were administered by DRA, as well as what the proposed fees will be. And as Mr. DeFebo said, we do hope that this will be a little bit easier and more friendly to the community as they are renting the park. You know, we are not doing individual services such as, you know, turning the fountain on and off at Circus Square or the use of the parking lot there at College Street and State Street, a tent and staking fee for tents that are erected in the park. We're just doing it all in a one lump fee. So we hope that that will be a little bit easier for the community, and it turns out to be a little bit cheaper as well in rental. And but you can see for Circus Square historically, since it has been in operation for the past 3 to 4 years, has really been the venue for the larger events that are held in downtown. And those events usually have live music, different booth rentals, food vendors, things like that for the community to come out and enjoy. So those large events, when you take in consideration your setup time, your actual event time, and then your teardown time, you know, it's usually a half a day rental or a full day that they're going to wind up being there. Well, one thing that we thought would be very good is that we are renting it, a full day is for 8 hours. But a lot of times, they're gonna use it for 10, 12, 14 hours that they're gonna be there, which would be the International Festival, for an example. But we're capping it at 8 hours. So it's not a 10-hour rental fee fully that they're getting. It is an 8-hour full day rental would be $800, which is basically, if you break it down, it's $100 per hour But even if they're there 10 to 12 hours, it's still $800. Okay? Does anybody have any questions about that one?
If I understand right, I just want to make sure. If they're going to pay for 8, but if they're for 10, they're only going to pay for 8.
That's correct.
Thank you.
That's correct, yes. Then Fountain Square Park and Riverwalk Park historically have been the venues for smaller activities such as weddings, private weddings, things of that nature. Fountain Square Park, I think we could all say that that's usually where most people use the park is for weddings alone. But so with that, we did the same as DRA had, which is a 2-hour minimum of $150, and then each additional hour is $75. But again, the full day rental will be $600. A lot of times for larger weddings, they really want the park for more than 8 hours. They do a lot of setup, they do photography, and all of that. So again, that would be $600 for 8 hours plus. And everything else is included in that. I'm sorry, Commissioner, Mayor Denny?
You have full day rental, $800 on the Fountain Square.
You should have a correction. There's a correction that's up there that was handed out.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And the correction will show the $600, yes.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. That's no problem. Again, we're with all three parks. We're doing the cleanup and damage deposit accordingly, which is subject to being refunded back as long as the event organizers, you know, clean the park as we ask. Then they're subject to receiving that cleanup deposit back. Same for Riverwalk Park. It's the exact same fee structure as Fountain Square Park. Again, that park isn't utilized as much. I've noticed. Occasionally you will have a small gathering that's there, but it's just not utilized nearly as much as Fountain Square and Circus Square. Okay.
Now, BJ, when somebody, first of all, we're going to have to advertise and let the public know who they are to call and so on. Right,
yes.
Now, really,
because yeah, there is information on the website that we've put on there, and we're going to do, once we had these fees established, we wanted to do some advertisement on our city page outsert as well as Channel 4 and use some of the resources that we have for advertisement of that. I have taken some rentals, but there has not been, it's all been for 2012. And so basically it's been a matter of penciling them in on the calendar and giving them an application, and I'm holding it until, you know, I have approval of these fees, and then I'll move forward with that. But there hasn't been any advertisement of fees or things of that nature. Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
On the cleanup deposit.
Yes.
Is there a specific list of what needs to be done in order to have achieved proper cleanup and receive the full deposit back? I can remember going through college and renting places, and it seemed like it changed all the time.
And it was vague?
I never got my deposit back, is what I'm saying.
Well, there is established rules and regulations.
I wonder why.
There is established rules and regulations that goes along with an application when someone is inquiring about the park and the rental of the park. In the rules and regulations, it stipulates what those things mean. What is their responsibility to do? As well as, you know, there's been a lot of things that has happened in the park, historically when we rented it before. You know, we've had events where there was silly string everywhere and it was left in the fountain. And so even that's mentioned in there. Silk flowers, if people use silk flowers for weddings and they wind up on the ground, they just never seem to go away. So all of those things are addressed in the rules and regulations.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome. Is there any other questions? Yes.
How do we define what an event is where they have to actually pay to be there?
To be there?
Mm-hmm.
First off, it would be, for instance, like a wedding. And usually the weddings that are held down there are very large weddings. And so, of course, that would require a fee because that's going to be reserving the park for a considerable amount of time.
So that's the key, reserving the park for that individual as opposed to Doc Kalen walking a couple down who walks into the courthouse.
That's correct, married. Yes. I mean, if he walks those folks down there, I mean, if I don't know about that, then, you know, it wouldn't be reserved. Hopefully they wouldn't be interfering with anyone else that's maybe rented the park. And I'm sure that has happened. I mean, you know, the park has been utilized. I mean, it's a public park. There's been several activities that have been held over there, but either they weren't commercialized or they were very small groups that maybe just walked over there like prom pictures. I know that there's been a lot of schools that have gone over there to take prom pictures. You know, we don't reserve the park for that. That's on their own time, either before dinner, after dinner, or however that they're doing that. But, you know, reservation of the park, if it's going to encumber the actual use of the park to where you're utilizing the grounds and, you know, you're having a big event that is there, you know, even with a wedding. You know, sometimes even a wedding that has just 100 members, they'll have chairs and things of that nature. Then they want to rent the park for that.
So like if one of the gubernatorial candidates were going to come and speak on the square, they still have to rent that and provide insurance? And
Well, not necessarily insurance. And that also depends on how much it is commercialized. If there is a lot of advertisement, you know, come and join us. If there's heavy advertisement to where there could be, you know, 1,000 people that show up, then that could be a higher risk than, let's say, someone goes over there and they have, 50 folks that show up. That's not going to be as high of a risk. Other risk factors would be if they're going to, have music that's playing or any type of food vendors or retail vendors, things like that. Those are all higher risks that are held. So each of those have to be looked at individually as they are requested as to what the insurance need would be.
I think there's a difference between insurance and exclusivity. If someone's renting the park, do they want to take a chance that they're going to be using the park for an event, then have 400 other people riding their bikes, playing in the fountain? People, when they rent it, they want exclusive use of either all or part of the facility.
That's
judgment
correct.
You make it first. Exclusivity.
That's correct.
Reservation.
Yes. Yes. That's correct.
So I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
How are we going to notify John Q. Public that I've rented the whole park? What type of marketing signage are we going to use? Because I know on occasion I've seen in the past, like out at Paul Walker, the gizmos that you eat.
Yeah, the gazebos.
Yeah, and the tables. A lot of times people will be sitting there and somebody has rented it and they show up and
they have to move.
Well,
I can speak for Fountain Square Park in particular, because again, Circus Square is more community oriented events. You know, really Fountain Square Park is more of the private type events to where they aren't going to really want other people to show up. maybe not. One thing that we do is we post all of the events that are scheduled on the calendar for the city website. So you can go to each of those parks and see what dates are available and what dates have already been secured and booked. That's one way of notification to the public. Another is that I am in email groups with the Fountain Square business merchants, the downtown business merchants, and I send them notifications every month of what is booked in the park so they too are aware of the different activities that are going to be happening. Another way is that a lot of times with large events, there's reservation of parking spaces. And when we put those out, we have our Public Works Department that does that. We actually put signage up that says special event with what it is and the date and time. That's on there as well too. So that's another way of notifying. Of course, we're not going to reach everybody in the public, but it's been my experience in the years that whenever I rented the park that a lot of people are just very considerate of what is going on in the parks. You know, they may stand back and watch and they may look, but I have never received any complaints in the years that I did it to where anyone just interrupted or interfered or caused any type of a disturbance to the folks whenever they rent these parks.
Maybe we, it raises a good question. Maybe we can put that on a calendar on our website as an ongoing calendar. So if people have an interest in, you know, using one of the parks, they could find out, first of all, whether it's been privately rented or not.
Mm-hmm. And again, those are those will be posted on the calendar dates, if it's a private wedding or a public event.
Do we have a chain or anything we can go around, say, Fountain Square, and put signs maybe on the chain, private event?
No. Now, in the past, we have not, but that could be something that we could look at. I will tell you something that I've advised, for instance, you know, particularly for weddings, because that's mainly what we're talking about if it's exclusive. Everything else is public. They want people there. I have recommended to those folks that they take ribbon or tooling and go around the outer perimeter of the park with the lamppost. And a lot of times that's very decorative and it adds to their event. And a lot of times people have done that if they've been concerned. That way it forces people to have to go through the archways, and then they can have ushers at the archways and things of that nature. So there are people that have done that.
I would like to see us investigate how much the plastic, white plastic chaining would be. So that's another service
okay.
we could offer.
Sure. Absolutely, that's a good idea. And we can look at doing that and see how much that would be.
Bruce?
Yeah, I don't think I'm finished with the
It's
political season. So if one of the gubernatorial candidates shows up in the back of a pickup and just starts talking, and they may have broadcasted for the last day or so, there wasn't anything scheduled in the park.
Yes.
He needs to pay, or he doesn't have to pay?
Well, I would say that, you know, now give me the scenario one more time, because I want to be clear that I answered this correctly.
He's on a schedule, and he finds out yesterday that he's going to be here today, and they put it on the radio for today, and he shows up in the back of a pickup truck with a megaphone and talks to the people that are standing in the park. That's an event, and there may be 500 people there may be 20 people there, I don't know, but...
Yeah.
Are we going to send somebody down and run him off, I guess?
No, that would not be the case, no. And you know, usually with bookings of the park, we ask for at least 30 days advance notice with bookings. So if it, and there has been situations before in the past where there was different candidates, different state elected candidates that were running and would house themselves in the park that we didn't know anything about, but, you know, we didn't run anybody off, and it's usually a short, brief, you know, ceremony. Usually, hopefully, it's not during a time when something else has been booked, but you would think that when they would show up, they would see that, and they would choose not to do that.
Yeah, if it was booked, clearly they'd have precedence on it.
They would have that, yes.
Okay.
They would see that.
Thanks.
Does that, okay.
My question is, and I think I probably have a little different position on it than Commissioner Wilkerson, okay. is I think he's trying to ensure that they don't pay if they're showing up, but who's responsible if a political candidate in a statewide race wants to use the park and puts out on their Facebook page or Twitter or social media, I'm going to be at Fountain Square Park, come down and hear what I have to say for a Q&A session. A bunch of people show up, somebody trips and busts their head open, and they don't have their $1 million of liability insurance. Mm-hmm. Who's going to pay for that? Taxpayers?
Well, it would be on the city. It would.
So I guess my preference would be then, if you're inviting the public to the park.
That's correct.
Yes. Then it's a paid reserved event that you're going to have insurance for and go through the process for. Otherwise, I don't want to see the taxpayers have to pick up the charge.
That's
on
correct.
An event that they were invited to attend.
That's right. And I would say that, you know, If I'm contacted or notified and given that time frame to where we can go through that process, then that would be the process that we would go through. But again, as he was saying too, you know, somebody just kind of shows up the next day, we don't really know anything about it, but then we find out about it. You know, I'm not certain that, you know, we would actually run them off and or do that. But there has been instances where people don't really know that they need to reserve the park, and they have shown up down there without our knowledge until after the fact. But yes, I agree with you. If someone contacts me 30 days in advance, they're inquiring about the park, they want to rent the park, then all of those things are given to them as far as the rules, the regulations, the requirements, and things of that nature. We will go through that process.
But if there's no enforcement of it, then I can guarantee you that we're not going to hear from. I mean, I believe that. If it's follow this rule, but if you don't, there are no consequences to following the rule.
Right.
Then it's too easy, whether it's a political campaign or something else, to say, well, we'll just show up and send out word via social media, which, I mean, during the primary season and even the last national election, I can't tell you how many invites I received through social media of people being at Fountain Square Park.
Really? Yeah.
On both sides of the ticket.
Yes.
The party was irrelevant there. I got tons of invites that said, at noon at Fountain Square Park, this political candidate's going to be there.
I think if it's ad hoc, they don't have one exclusive use of the park. So anybody could have a dual rally or a dual pronunciation at that time. Two is, since they did not pay, they get no courtesy of free restrooms, no courtesy of electric, no courtesy of the water fountain turnoff, no courtesy of parking near the water fountain, none of the things that those who pay get. So if they want to run an event like that on the fly,
and all that's fine with me. My concern is, in the event of unforeseen occurrences happening, I don't want to see the taxpayer have to pay the bill for an event that was scheduled. I mean, if person A walks down to Fountain Square and trips in a hole and, you know, hurts themselves just because they're down there, then and somehow the city's negligent, I believe we're responsible for that. Mm-hmm. But if somebody walks down there and falls in a hole because they were invited by somebody else, I don't think that the mass taxpayer should have to be responsible for that negligence. I mean, so I'm less concerned about whether or not the water fountain's on or where they park and things, although it's a very good point to make.
Yeah,
it would be better for you to schedule to have those
and
things.
Pay the nominal. Could you, if you're a nonprofit, you get a courtesy reduction. If you want to do it correctly and make sure you have all the services and the restrooms available and the whole bit. Part of our rationale today was just to sunshine this to you with our ideas and then to formalize your will via municipal order, which we'll present either next month, next meeting or the meeting after, that would have all these rules of engagement and what is an event. And Gino's not here, so, but we just wanted to see if you're okay with this logic of reducing the multiple layers of fee structure, making it easier for people to get insurance, trying to be helpful, you know, in use of the facility. That was our main intent today.
From what Bobby Joe presented, I think it's right. These other questions, particularly as it relates to political parties, I think we'll be running on some real sandy ground if we tried to limit someone's First Amendment rights to speak in a public area. And again, I think your point's well taken. They don't get all of the conveniences of having it, but it's still a public area, and it would seem like they could host an impromptu, unless it is reserved from someone, then I guess it takes it out of that arena of being public.
If I'm a political handler, and my candidate is coming to Circus Square, I want as many people there who have exclusive use of the park in the most comfortable environment possible. And the fee is not that high for a 1 hour rally. It's
that
a
would
formal
assume,
1 hour rally.
That would assume
rally.
Planning on the part of a politician. I'm not sure we're in that era. I'm not, we'll leave that conversation. I'm just messing.
But then you get the ad hoc people, which we all had over the past year, where they would show up at Circus Square or Fountain Square and make a 10-minute soundbite for the evening news, and they would go on. That's a little different story, I think.
That's correct.
But I'm think what you all have put together here, as far as the information, Bobby Joe, that you presented,
I personally
am fine with that.
Thank you.
I think the ability to purchase insurance, City Manager DeFebo and I have talked about that in the past, that that can be a real obstacle for some organizations. They don't even know where to begin. I think the fact that we're now providing them with an avenue to purchase their own.
Yes, that's new. We never had that before, so that definitely is a positive.
Give Dave Weisbrot. I tasked him to find something, and he went out and found it. So
yeah, I think that's great.
Any other? Good job, BJ.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Item number two, Mr. City Manager.
Mr. Gary presented a request to the city concerning his interest in taking over the management of the Paul Walker Golf Course. It was our collective wisdom that we should, since this is a large issue having many facets of concern, to turn it over to the Park Board and for them to study it and to make a recommendation to you all. I think all the forces that are involved in this issue have met, and I think the Park Board has for you a recommendation. I'm not sure who the speaker was. I think it's John Deep.
John.
John, as president of the Park Board, is going to basically make their recommendation. Then Mr. Gary's here if you have any questions, and you have other information provided by Gene Harmon and others concerning the legal aspects of this. And I've shared everything I've had with Mr. Gary as soon as I got it. So,
thank you, Mr. Bebo. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good to be with you today. My name is John Deeb. I think it's first important to note that the Parks Board is here with you today. And I want to acknowledge six of the seven members that are with us. Dr. Alton Little, of Coomer Little fame, he is with us. Tom Richards, Daily News, just raise your hand so they can see who you are. Ron Ramsey, professor at Western. Lewis Burke, development of Vampire, right? And Dean Broche, ladies professional golfer. Right? All right. And one member is not with us, Grant Klein. He couldn't get off work. So we have prepared and tendered to you a report. And I think we need to preface my comments on this. Greg Gary, when I was a freshman in high school, he led our high school team to the state golf tournament championship. From that point forward, I had the highest respect for him. And since then, as a person, as a businessman, as a community contributor, he's a fantastic person. And I want to make it perfectly clear that this report is not about Greg Gary, the person. Greg Gary is an A1 person. This report is about a proposal, a business proposal from Greg Gary that the board has deliberated on quite extensively. And I will tell you straight up front at the beginning, we have voted 7-0 against the proposal. We are recommending against it. We recognize it's your ultimate decision, but we're not in favor of it. And we spent a number of hours deliberating. Greg has met with us on several occasions to answer questions in writing and in person. We've talked extensively about it, and we've drafted up a little report for you that's a couple of pages long, and it tells you some information, and I'm here to answer questions on other information if you have questions. But I do want to say that we have solicited the advice of Gene Harmon and the advice of Ernie Gubas, our director who's here with us today, and our golf professional, Bob Jeffers, who's here with us today. They're here available to answer questions. They answered a lot of questions that we had. But generally speaking, a couple of reasons we don't think it's an appropriate business decision for us to make, for us to accept. We don't think the privatization of our own asset is a good fit for the neighborhood. Primarily, Mr. Gary's proposal says, I'm going to take total control of this golf course. I'm going to hire and fire employees. I'm going to set their wages. I'm going to set their benefits. I'm going to be in charge of how many people work there. And not really, I mean, he will certainly give consideration to existing employees that have been there and given their life service to our golf courses, but they're not guaranteed to stay in. He would have total control over the pro shop, the buildings, and all the land there. And we don't think that's a good idea for the city to give up total control of our asset. Not that he would do a bad job, but it's just not good policy. We have a park in front of the golf course. We have neighbors all around the golf course. We have to answer to. And if he puts up a fence or puts up a light or you know, paints something this color, does something, you know. We've got an answer to it, but we have no control over that asset. He does. But we, you, answer to the citizens about how our asset's being managed. And so we don't think that's a good idea. On the legal standpoint, we've been advised by Gene Harmon that the request for proposal procedure must be followed in order to lease out or sell an asset of the city. We concur. We advise that if you choose to go through this process, that you do open to competitive bidding. However, that's probably going to take Mr. Gary out of the box. I don't think he's going to be a player, because he has said that he will not submit a bid, and he can speak for himself, but I mean, he told us if it involves the sharing of gross revenue with the city, he won't submit a bid. He wants to lease the land for a flat fee. He didn't say what it would be. We don't know from a dollar on. I guess that's subject to negotiation. But he will not share in revenue. And we think for it to be competitive, best bid opportunity for the city, it's got to involve revenue sharing. And that takes him out of the box. And for us to keep out of lawsuits and keep in line with Gene Harmon and our purchasing agent and all that, we need to do the right thing and go through the RFP process. We don't think that Mr. Gary's going to participate if that's the case. He can speak for himself, but we just don't think it's a good idea to give up control of this beautiful asset that's been around for a long time. It's the part of the heart and soul of our city. Many neighbors have lived around there for years, and we don't think that it fits with the goals of the Parks Department providing services to our community to privatize a big asset like that. So, that being said, I'm going to speak a little bit less and let you all ask your questions. And any Parks Board members have any comments you want to add to that? Sure. All right. We're open for questions.
Any questions we have our proposal. For John?
I'm sorry?
Any questions for John? Bruce?
I appreciate the time and effort that all of you put in there. I was reading through the report and didn't come across the reasoning there that you explained, so I appreciate that information. What intrigued me about the offer is not only the man that presented it and his reputation in the community, but the opportunity to address the amount of subsidy that the city is providing for golf in the community. Did y'all look at any part of that in your report?
We did, yes.
Can you tell me what the thought process was on that?
We got information from golf professional Bob Jeffers about the subsidy from last year. It was approximately, my memory serves me correctly, $179,000. The city subsidized the golf course. But of that, if my memory serves me correctly, about $103,000 of that was administrative costs. It's going to be paid anyway, regardless if the golf course is in someone else's hands or not. So there's some money being put in from the city coffers to take care of the golf course, and we think that's appropriate. We're a big advocate of the golf course. We think it's a good service to our community, and that's not too much money to put in there.
No doubt about that. I was just looking at, you know, they provided the information for all three of the golf courses, and the city provides about $924,000 last year for the three of them, and it seemed like quite a lot, nearly a third of the entire park's budget. And I was intrigued at the fact that we had an opportunity to reduce that and still have a good operation.
But in relation to the city's entire budget, those are some great services provided to our community.
We
make no apologies for that kind of money or that kind of service or that kind of an asset. It's a great asset.
I don't disagree with you there. That argument is made for every
of course
particular group that comes forward. It's just that little bit. So
right.
I, and again, that has nothing to do with how it's being run or anything right. like that. We were approached with an opportunity, and it certainly seemed like it was worth exploring. I'll let some other people talk here while I'm getting my thoughts
all
together
right.
and something else.
Any other questions?
I have one, and it may involve Mr. Gary. Mm-hmm. If indeed, John, that, and we've heard from Gene too, that we require an RFP, And I guess I'd like to hear from Mr. Gary as in terms of what you said, that he may not participate in that. And if he would not participate in that, and our city attorney says we need it, then this whole thing is moot.
It's done.
So, right. Mr. Gary, if you come up, and this, if I'm out of line asking, sorry, Joe.
It's all right. You're out of line.
All right. It's not the first time. Won't be the last time, I guarantee you.
Of course, I haven't looked.
Greg,
we've got the TV folks. Want
I haven't here. Looked at the requirements as far as the beating. I hadn't had my attorneys look at it, but I guess the way I see what I am trying to do, I'm not trying to sell the city anything to purchase. I'm looking to alleviate some of the liability financially that the city has, and in turn, go ahead and keep the part that I'm wanting to lease in the same aspect as far as service-wise to the community. I'll be a good neighbor. I'll be a good steward of the property. I'll run everything in a professional manner. And before I do anything that might get some kind of comment from the neighborhood, you know, I'll go door to door. Anything that I make changes, because like I said, I grew up right there against the golf course, and in other business ventures that I have, I know that, you know, you have to be part of the community, so you have to be a good citizen of the community, and that's what I, you know, would plan on doing with this venture, just as I, you know, do with any of my others. I don't know if I didn't get across my ideas well enough, but I'm not looking to be a part of this, the way the city runs anything or the way the Parks and Recs runs anything. I'm looking to take a liability that the city has financially and take it and run it in my opinion, in as high quality of manner and as a professional manner as what it's being run, or a higher standard than what it is now. In my proposal, I propose to spend money that is budgeted in the city's budget next year, up and above and beyond what it's going to take to run the golf course, to rework the greens. And in the report that was shared to me from the Parks and Rec Board, their mission, they feel, is a service mission, and how better to service the community than to take an asset and release some of the liability to where you can take those funds and use it elsewhere to service in a better manner other portions of the parks and other portions of the city. I don't want to be painted as a villain, you know, here. I'm just trying to give a novice idea that is in for consideration to work along, you know, with the city, you know, in this business venture, and try to make it successful for not only myself but for the city also. And as far as the bidding goes, sharing in the gross revenues of any type of business in the private sector, I don't know that is a format with any business sharing, you know, gross revenues. Now, I can see sharing the net revenues, but there again, I just feel like that just a set fee per year is the most common sense way to go, And that's the way I arrived at it, because I'm just kind of a common sense business person that wants to try to take any kind of shadow or any kind of out of any kind of situation to where it's not up front and on the table at all times. And that's why I felt like the set fee would be the best, and still feel that way. And I think I can honestly say that if it is put out for bids and you tie it to a gross revenue, no, you will not get any bids from anybody across the nation, because in the private world, we just don't do business that way. And I mean, it's going to be your all's decision on what you feel like is the best for the citizens of Bowling Green, and what you feel like is the best steward of the taxpayers' dollars. And so that's just, you've kind of heard my heart, and you know, I appreciate the opportunity to be heard and be considered, and feel it as an honor, you know, but I'm hoping that as we go forward that we can work together and make this a realization.
So Greg, if there is a request based on law for other proposals, you still in?
Well, I would be, you know, under the consideration of, I'm bringing you a novice idea and a novice proposal. If you write it to my proposal, then, you know, you're writing it set for me. And if you write it under a proposal of sharing gross revenues, then, like I said, not only will I not be interested, but, you know, nobody would be. So I guess my feelings is on it, you know, if you're going to write it in a way that you know nobody's going to bid on it, then there's no sense in you all spending the time and effort to write the bids, the expense of putting it out just to rule me out. So, you know, that's just kind of where I'm at as far as the bid process. I don't feel like, you know, there'll be any bids anyway, because not that I'm aware of anybody coming in the last 50 years wanting to lease one of the golf courses. You know, if it has to be, then it has to be. But a lot of it is how you write the bid and how you tie everything down. You've got to give anybody the freedom to be able to take a facility and be able to do what they feel like it needs to be done to make it successful, and to not, you know, have to be micromanaged, and every time you're wanting to do anything, you have to come and get permission from, you know, different boards and all. It has to be, you have to have enough confidence in whoever you're going to accept the bid that they can do it, and then they have to have enough confidence in you all as a commission that you all are going to be fair and workable to be able to, you know, make it a realization.
I think, excuse me, the last time that you were here, I commended you for bringing this idea forward. And when citizens do that, I think it behooves us to obviously look at it in a very sincere way. And mirroring what Bruce said is, I do think it's an intriguing idea. And I think that, I don't know how this is going to come out, but in a time where if some items can be privatized and save the city taxpayers money, I think that we have to take that very seriously. And so what I'm hearing you saying is that you would be involved in the RFP process as long as it was a process where you thought that you could be successful. So it's not that if we have the RFP process, Greg Gary's out. It's just that you'd have to look at the RFP and see if it was something you wanted to do.
Right, yeah. When I was asked the question, it was asked to me If it was written to where you shared in gross revenues, would I be in or out? And I said that, you know, under those circumstances that I would be out. You know, as you, the communities grow and your park services grow, not only in the city and the county, you're going to have to, at some point in time, look and see, if I build this new park, what is it going to cost me to maintain it each year? And set, you know, the fees for the usage kind of accordingly. And, you know, as going for a service side, you can eat a little bit of the loss each year, but what two parks eat might not be that significant, but after you build 20 of them, what 20 parks eats, you know, becomes a large, you know, sum. And I just feel like that as the communities grow and as time goes on, that you're going to have to look at different avenues on how, you know, to better service not only the citizen, but of being the steward of the tax dollars that are paid in.
Melinda?
Greg, I'd just like to thank you for thinking outside the box. I think this is a fine example of why our community is successful, because we have business people willing to think outside of the box. So I want to thank you for that. Not sure the direction we're going to go with this, but I will tell you on a personal level, if we went this direction, I can't imagine a finer person running it than you.
Thank
you. So thank you.
Any other? City manager?
Would you be interested in looking at an arrangement with Riverview Golf Course?
Not at this time, I wouldn't. It's going to be the next course that you're going to have to renovate. From what I've heard from different golfers that have played down there, you're going to probably be better off renovating it before you would the greens at Covington, because they said that they've gotten, you know, pretty bad shape. Of course, they've had a lot of trouble over the years down there by it being built on an old landfill. I know the number one green just kept falling in, and they finally had to move it up to the top of the hill. When I was in high school, we played down there, and you used to hit it between the two big trees down over the hill to the green, but after it fell in two or three times, it got to where it just wasn't, you know, repairable. You know, under the circumstances and the conditions, you know, I wouldn't be at this time.
Kevin?
Yes.
If we were to talk about a 10-year with the 10-year option, I think that's what we had initially at least been exposed to. Could we have numbers? And I know John mentioned that maybe if we were still going to assume $103,000, no matter what we do, can we have Jeff or Ernie, someone fill out something to show us what 10 years would look like?
10 years of?
10 years, not 10 years of what we would be paying anyway, and 10 years projected, just use a number of projection on what we would save over a 10-year period of time. Right. I know that's difficult, but I think I need to see something to give me a little bit more of an idea of what type of money that we are actually talking about saving the taxpayers.
Plus, I think you need to ask a critical question, what is in that amount? What's included in that amount?
Yeah. Because again, if we have a certain amount of monies and we're going to pay that money anyway, then it may make a difference in what my thinking would be. But then again, but I'll go back and say the idea of, I know that some cities, I saw a cartoon the other day, said it was just not, why not privatize all the government, just shut it down? It was, at the time, it was a kind of cute cartoon, but then I thought about this. But I think there is, again, very good points in looking at some privatization. And I think this is a good one to at least look at. I'm interested in moving forward with some things.
I think part of the issue and or problem is we've been working off one sheet presented to us. When you do business, you have your own interest. It might be more appropriate for us to put together an RFP for those elements that we think are important, that may or may not include a percentage of the gross. I'm not an expert in private sector, but I think it is used in some franchise agreements, that you pay a percentage of the gross of the what is sold to different franchisees. It may not be common, but it is out there. I'm not sure that's the drop-dead issue for us. The issue for us is writing an RFP that protects the city's interest as well and meets the legal requirements. For example, in the we just recently rented or leased the running place at Kariakas. Even though we responded to a letter, we went out and put A through D of conditions that protected the city. We have a responsibility to protect the city. If you're saying to us, this deal is not over, that we need you to go out and write an RFP that may or may not be in our interest and is fair to whoever would respond, including Mr. Gary, we can do that. We haven't put together an RFP with our needs. Are you not concerned about the neighbors in the area of the golf course?
Yes.
Paul Walker. Yes. So would you want that in your lease agreement, that there has to be some protections for that?
I'm not sure what it would look like. I think what I'm saying is that I want some, I do want an RFP, obviously, to protect the city's interest would be paramount. But I also, I think before we can do an RFP to see if we want to do that, we have to have some numbers to see what money's, what a 10 years look would look like from us, from staff's perspective.
10 years of?
Of actually leasing it, of leasing the course. What would that potentially mean to us? Is it potential savings of $1 million over a 10-year period for taxpayers? With all these ancillary issues obviously have to be resolved, or is it a $100,000 savings over a 10-year period?
I'm not trying to be coy, but part of it, what he would pay us. There's no number on his side how much he was going to give us. You can only figure out the loss. You can't figure out both sides of it. If he's willing to pay us $300,000 a year to use our asset, that's a different story.
I think if we go back to that scenario, then we have to go back to what's in the best interest of the city. Maybe we say the best interest of the city. In an RFP, is we have to have $500,000, and again, that may take him out of the ballgame. But we might say that we have to have $150,000.
Right.
So I'm
or
saying
$110,000.
Or whatever it is. I'm just saying that I need more information on the potential cost over a 10-year period versus the potential gain over a 10-year period, and then in my mind, look at it and all the other things: the neighbors, the quality, the colors and all those things. Obviously, I think that the city needs to be protected and it could be an RFP, but I have to know the numbers first.
Okay, it also might be appropriate to ask Ernie to, because he spent considerable amount of time as your director looking at this issue. I know from talking to him personally, his feelings are, let's continue a dialogue, but we have to protect the city. So. It might be important to hear from Ernie if he's here.
Hi, Ernie Gouvis, thank you. We've gone through a lot of discussion about this, and I took my position as giving the board all the knowledge and insight, budget figures that we could, so they could make a full discussion of it and not be blindsided by anything. Stewardship of taxpayer money was paramount from my point of view. But to balance that with my experiences, especially those at Covington Woods, I guess there's two issues. Number one, just the nature of RFP, it had to go public in my perspective. You know, we did it with tracks running. I even did it with the dog wash. We put a national RFP out for that. So to me, that's how we have to do business. It has to be sunshined. And number two, our asset. You know, park golf course opened basically around 1930, so WPA building. Used to finance the whole parks department. There's a lot of sentimental value, a lot of emotions in that, and the sensitivity of the neighborhood. We're essentially be a landlord-tenant relationship. It's the way I saw it, and I don't have any landlord that would give a tenant full run of the facility without some safeguards on it. And just my experience with that park has been, is in a very vocal and a very involved neighborhood. Any change, we pretty much go surrounding properties and tell them what's going to go on in there. I can tell you some stories about if we had a lot of time, but I won't. But that was my main thing, is protecting our assets. We've got to have some control over it. As far as the percentage of revenue, as the Parks Board intent is, they want a more of a partnership relation instead of just a strict landlord-tenant relationship. I believe that's kind of where that came from. They wanted, you know, you work hard, want something, you know, it benefit both of us. My personal preference was I like just a flat fee because then you don't have to worry about the books. That was just basically my premise about it. But again, the two things were, you know, it's got to be an open process. Number two, without strict protections for asset, it's just not a good fit for Paul Walker Golf Course because of the proximity of it and the neighborhood. Hobson Grove may be better because basically aren't many neighbors, a lot less standard or duty of care there, plus the facility. The new pro shop might be beneficial if you try to do, you know, I think there's enough space in the garage. You could even do indoor hitting, lessons, club fitting, stuff like that. I'm not an expert on it, but I think it'd have a lot of possibilities. Then I guess getting back to your question, Commissioner Waltrip, is, you know, we can do that, but you want capital items included in it? For example, things.
Anything that I want, yeah. And I understand from being on the staff side of these things, I understand that some of these things may be conjecture on your all's part, yeah. But I want as many items in there so that I can make the best decision. And I'll also say, because at some point I would say it anyway, it's not just all about money, but I think, again, for me to be a good steward of everybody's mm-hmm. tax money, golfers, non-golfers, I think that I just need all that information yeah. to be able to make a decision.
Yeah.
And just ask y'all to do the best you can. We look at it and may ask more questions.
This is going to take some time yeah. for us to put this together thoughtfully. We've been working from what has been proposed. If you're asking us to put together what we think is an appropriate RFP that makes Mr. Gary and others attracted to the proposal, we can do that. But there is, for example, you have a mixed-use facility. Riverview, for example, doesn't have the same mixed-use facility. Here you have a park, a neighborhood park. How do you bifurcate that and make sure that the private golf course that is essentially privatized now doesn't meet and interact to some degree improperly with the playground that are being used by the neighborhood? So it's a more delicate nuance, and there has to be written in a proper way. The numbers are we would reduce our financial exposure by privatizing. That's clear. That there's no doubt about it. It's clear. So we can put together a longer perspective, but I think Ernie and his staff needs to look at putting together a two-way RFP.
And I would say that this conversation could not be complete without doing that. I don't think that we can make the proper decision in courtesy to the citizens unless we go that far. And obviously, I assume that it would be painstaking to do that.
Be painful.
Painful, maybe, to do that a little bit. But again, I think to give this the issue or the suggestion, it's full due and it's complete review. I think that we have to have that. Knowing that when you do the RFP, you have to have due diligence to be as concise. But again, in doing that, we look at the protections for the city. And I would, that would be foremost in my mind, obviously, is the protection of a city asset. But again, I think that I would be would not be doing my job correctly if I didn't see the full picture before I was asked to make a decision.
Yeah, you're right. It's been everything there from colors to tree limbs to where brush is, you name it. It's a very involved neighborhood.
And even though it'll be privatized, you'll still have the issues. Cause
yeah. I think Greg's phone will ring.
We got the issue in the paper today from a letter to the editor, Andrew, about a tax increase, and we haven't increased any taxes in the city at all, and we still get credit for raising taxes. We get credit when we do raise tax, or we get credit for, let's see, it was a letter to the editor. It wasn't editorial, Tommy, so I'm not dare say anything about that.
Nor does Andrew, I found out from yelling at him several times, have anything to do with the letters to the editor.
And I don't know how I got onto that, John, but I'm just saying we didn't raise anybody's taxes. So anyway.
You sound like a lawyer going on and on.
Okay.
Oh, Lord, don't say that to me. No, I'm just kidding.
What are we asking? And
may I add one more thing, Mayor?
Okay.
Well, actually, two things. First of all, while Mr. Gary is obviously a first-class entrepreneur, lost in this discussion has been the fact that we are blessed with a first-class golf professional and staff. And there have been no complaints about the job of Bob Jeffers and his staff, Tony Whitmer. The golf courses are run quite well. They're in quite good condition. And we want to remember that. This kind of sounds like an indictment against them. And I know Greg doesn't intend that to be the case. No. But they're doing a fabulous job. And we as a board are very pleased with what they're doing. The second thing, I want to try to make you aware of something that we may not be thinking about if we go forward with this process and actually do it. We may create a situation where our golf courses are competing against each other. And I'm not sure we want that. You decide that. You're the greater minds with the vote and the decision to make. But if Gary takes over Paul Walker and he sets the prices, and he sets the season golf pass prices, whether they can even do it or not, in the ladies' day, in the golf tournaments. And he's competing against our other two golf courses to bring in revenue for his pocket. And that's a good businessman to do that. But we are setting up a framework for that to happen with this process. And I just wanted to, if you're gonna go through with RFP and you wanna exclude certain things or protect the city, you might wanna give that some consideration.
Bruce?
Sorry to muddy the waters, but.
Well, that's a good point. That's a very good point.
Yes, Bruce.
I want to get back to originally the report, and I'll use my John Deeb language here. Would it be fair to say that the opinion of the board is that Parks and Rec is providing the parks and recreation service to the community just as we provide police service or fire service or public works service, and that with their percentage of the budget, then they should decide how that's most appropriately used to support that service. Am I reading that correctly?
I think that's a statement, isn't it?
I'm asking.
You're asking.
That's what you do to me on the stands. That's what I'm asking.
I can't disagree with what you're saying. I'm not sure I understand it fully. It's a bifurcated statement, but.
I don't want to misunderstand the point of the board. Is okay. that Parks and Rec is a service. I think Dr. Little is actually, and I may be misquoting him, I apologize, that Parks and Rec Parks and Recreation is a service mm-hmm. that the city should provide.
Absolutely.
It's a budgeted service. Mm-hmm. This is how it most appropriately should be spent.
We're good with it, yes. We're okay. good with it the way it is.
No.
And that's why we voted 7-0 against the proposal to move forward.
Okay.
Slim?
Mayor. I think, and I don't know Mr. Gary, and so please don't misunderstand a word I'm saying. I've asked at least 30 people about you, and everybody said good things, so I wish I had the same luck.
Yes, one.
Yeah, I asked one and quit. So it doesn't have anything to do with you, what I'm about to say, but I just want to make sure that I'm not painted into a corner as being in a contest with Greg Gary, because I'm not. I played golf all my life. The city of Indianapolis has ventured into something like you're suggesting here, and I've looked at that model some since your proposal came forward and even before, because I've talked to Mr. DeFebo about it, I've talked to Bob Jeffers, I've talked to Tony Whitmer about it in the past. But what I don't want to be lost in this overall discussion, and Bruce started to hit on it a little bit, is
that from this individual commissioner's perspective, we don't demand that Kariakas Park make the city a profit. We don't demand that the tennis courts that sit at Covington Woods Park and Paul Walker Golf Course make a profit. I think parks are to be provided to citizens to improve their quality of life, and you improve their quality of life by providing the venue where they recreate. Not, we don't improve their quality of life by saying, we provided you this venue and we made X amount of dollars, or we broke even, or we lost money. It's the sheer providing of the opportunity is what I believe government does, what government originally intended to do when we started, when government years ago started providing places for people to recreate. And so I wish that the golf courses turned a profit for no other reason than it would make them less of a target for people to complain about. But I don't play tennis. I don't. I used to. I'm not very good at it. But a portion of the taxes that I pay in the city go to tennis. I nearly don't have children who swing on swing sets. But a portion of my taxes goes to pay for swing sets. I love the park, but I don't skateboard. But a portion of my taxes goes to the skate park. And the same can be said about golf, because what I hear routinely said about golf is, well, it's a fee for service kind of thing. Well, we could install meters on swing sets if we wanted to, but it's a ridiculous concept. And so I just don't want to get, I think too often when we talk about golf, what I hear is that we separate golf and potentially even the water park as something different than a park. And in the end, what we're trying to do is provide a place for people to recreate. And that costs money.
And I might add, in our deliberations, more than one person has said that the only department in city government that makes a profit is the treasurer. That's it. Everybody else is upside down, every single department. It's all providing services to our community with our taxpayer dollars, and you allocate those. We like the allocation of the Parks and Rec, and we think it should stay the same.
Any other?
One other statement, and I know that with what I've said, and again, it may be in the minority, with what I've said, I know, I believe that the issues with employees and city staff, that it has to be very alarming to them, not knowing or having this up in the air, and I understand that. But again, I think that, as I stated, I think that we should move forward. You brought up competition. I think that's one of the things you brought up in the report. And I would say, generally speaking, competition is not bad. It makes both people better. So that's, Josie asked me to stop speaking, so I'll let it go with that.
But and I agree with you, competition is better. But competing against oneself is nearly insane, even in the private sector. I mean, Walmart doesn't try to put Walmart out of business. I mean, there's a reality to that. And so I agree with you. Competition is good, but if you really want to try to apply a classic business model, as Mr. Gary is, and I think probably based upon his success, he knows what he's doing, but setting up the framework to compete against our own asset is not better from the city standpoint, in my opinion.
Like two convention centers.
And my,
let's see. And a third on the way.
I had a thought. But generally speaking, Mr. D, if private business can do something better and government can save taxpayers' money and we have the city protected and we have all these things come together, then the government needs to get out of it, generally speaking. And that's not a blanket comment. I understand that. And I don't disagree with a lot of what Slim said there. But I think that I would like to see more to go forward to see what decision I'm making instead of just cutting it off now. And realizing that it's tough on everybody. But these are tough times. And as we move forward, some of the traditional ways we've been doing things as government has to curtail or stop. And we're going through that process. And we have been for a while. But I think it's even more important to look at it now.
Slim?
Yes.
I did. One of the items that you brought up, I asked Mr. DeFebo to try to do some research to get us a little better handle on how much does it cost the city to provide a place to play tennis or basketball or so forth, just so we get some idea of what, you know, because this may be an appropriate expenditure. So he's going to look that information up for us.
You've got a lot of people that want to speak.
Yeah. I just want to say one last thing. I know exactly what you're looking for as far as the financial part of it. If we've decided, I guess, to move forward to hear in more depth, get farther along in the process, I'm going to have accountants look at all the books anyway. And if it's agreeable with everyone, I'd be more than happy to, after I have my accountants look at everything, to share all those numbers with you, and it'll show you if your all's books are the type that I would think that they would be. It'll show you where every penny's been spent, and I can have them break it out to what is associated with the Walker course and what is not associated with the Walker's course, to where you can see exactly how much over the last 4 or 5 years that you all have supplemented in, not only from your parks budget, but from your general fund, that would be the savings that you would have.
Thank you.
So you all can just, you know, talk about it or whatever you want to do, and just let me know. I know everybody that was with the city has plenty of things to do than to go back through the years, you know, prior to and get, you know, budget figures together and break it all out the way that you were asking to have it done. And that's exactly what I would have my accountants do. So I'd be more than happy to supply that service if you'd like for me to.
Mr. Jeffries.
I guess a couple things. One of them would be a simple solution. We try to keep the price of golf low with this golf course. If you don't want to subsidize it, we'll raise the price accordingly. And that's an answer. Part of the discussion with Mr. Gary, the city had no control over pricing. I'm sure Mr. Gary would want to make the golf course competitive, but he's also going to have an investment in it to where the price wouldn't be what it is now. With that said, the golf division Paul Walker Golf Course has several things hanging out there that have to be addressed one way or the other. One of them is that we're looking at regrassing the golf course in Bermuda Greens next June. The company that does this, and there's only two actually, one's half price of the other one and they have a good product, but they have to have a signed contract from us in order to get on their schedule. We've been putting them off now for several months. That's one issue. Another issue is, in order to regrass the greens, we have to make irrigation improvements in this golf course, which is in our budget to do that next year. In order to do that, we have to get with Public Works, write up the specifications for that, put a bid and put it out, which would take some time, and that was something that we'd have to do in the next few months. Golf carts are in our budget to buy for all the golf courses, and strictly talking about Paul Walker here. So I guess what I'm asking you is, and we have some direction on, I mean, do we need to continue to put all this on hold, or do we need to go ahead and go through with these improvements? I know golf carts and regrassing the greens and the irrigation improvements is going to increase our revenues, even if we don't have it come next year if you turn it over to private management. So really, we're just kind of sitting in the wings. If we don't get on the Bermuda grass company's schedule, then it's going to be another year before this would possibly happen. So that's kind of our concern as a staff. A little comment, Mr. DeFebo touched on it. If a private operator can do it for less money than the city can, there's absolutely no doubt. There is some doubt in my mind if the private operator can do it as good as we do it. That's some of the things that people listening to this take for granted. We're going to have a good product or better than what we have now. Well, I don't think that's necessarily true. And I think maybe Mr. Gary had it with his reputation, that very well might be true, but putting it out for an RFP and all that, there's some question there. But where I come from there is we, as policy, are required pay into anybody that's a seasonal employee in our golf shop, and this is not a city rule, it's a retirement system. Any part-time employee that works in the golf course or works for the city for that matter that works over 1,200 hours a year, we have to pay into the retirement system for. A private operator wouldn't have to do that. Most golf courses like Kenny Perry's a private operator golf course, their staff's on salary, they don't pay overtime. At this particular Paul Walker Golf Course, we have about $15,000 in overtime costs related to policies. And I could go on and on and on, but my point is that there's no doubt that a private operator can do it for less, just because of the things that we have to pay being a government entity. But there again, I won't give in to the fact that they can do it as good as what we can, and we have a lot of accountability to you all related to presenting a good product for the city, and I think that you'll agree that you don't hear much feedback from any citizens related to the condition of the golf courses. We do experience problems with them sometimes, but we try to put an excellent product out there for them. So my biggest concern is just the schedule of things that we want to do and make improvements to increase the revenue at that golf course, and we're just kind of hanging out there for right now. So,
City Manager.
Given all the uncertainty, what benefit or non-benefit would be for us to put the Bermuda grass at Riverview now? Would that increase play there?
I feel like it would. It would. Tony and I have discussed this.
It's pretty rough there.
One thing about that golf course is the greens are very undulating, okay? And if you put Bermuda grass greens in the wintertime, they go dormant or they turn brown, okay? So the speed of a golf ball rolling across the green increases. Well, if you have a green with too much slope on it, which those greens do, you're going to putt the ball here and it's not going to stop rolling until it gets off the green. Okay, so what we would have to do is go to the greens and recontour most of them to where they're more of a level putting surface. They might have a little undulation in them, but they don't have a severe slope as what they do now. Tony and I figured in order to regrass them and to recontour the greens, you're looking at a cost of $130,000 compared to $35,000 for Paul Walker. That we wouldn't have to make the irrigation improvements over there because the irrigation system's in good shape. But so you're looking at almost $100,000 in additional cost if we were to do Riverview.
Would that help close the deficit at Riverview and substantiate its future? Because all of us talk about the future of Riverview. If we were going to lose a golf course, that would be the one that has the most need and probably
least
play.
I would have to say yes, it would. That's our least played golf course of the three, but a lot of it's because of the location of it. Mm-hmm. But absolutely, it would increase the revenues at that facility, as well as it doing it at Paul Walker. We've had a good year at Paul Walker. The greens are in good shape this year. The ones at Riverview, we've had two tough years to where they're not. So.
One final thing,
okay.
Mayor, if I may, and the four of you can disagree, Mr. DeFebo can disagree. One of the questions that I heard Mr. Jeffers ask is, does he proceed with the greens?
Yeah.
And I guess I want to make sure, because I never heard it, don't remember hearing it. I don't think there's any reason that the golf operation, I don't think there's anything that we've done that would stop the golf operation from moving forward with whatever they have had approved in their budget.
Well, I hear a little differently, and maybe Mr. Gary could jump up here. What I heard him say, he's not a huge fan of that particular methodology and actually would rebuild the whole greens, right? So if he put this in, if he take control, he'd be tearing it out. And there's no free ride, so that'd have to be recovered somehow. So there is actually a bottleneck, as Bob's saying. That's why I raised the issue of Riverview. Should we invest the money right now while we're having all these discussions of golf course futures to at least invest in Riverview?
I believe we should proceed with. I'm just stating my opinion.
But I am correct. You would not. You would tear them out, right?
Right. But the loss of play time would be, almost the same as far as growing in.
But in terms of us investing money in something, you would tear out.
Yeah, you all wouldn't invest any money in it. If the irrigation system needed to be upgraded to sustain the greens, I would have to do that also. I'm not looking to lease a piece of property and then come back to the city saying, well, I need money for irrigation or I need money for this. More than know going in that money's going to have to be spent, and I'm willing to spend that amount of money that it takes to do it.
Would it be appropriate to, because I've stated my position, but if there's a consensus, I don't know what the consensus is here, whether it's to move forward or to stop and just say no. Mine would be to, again, is to dig a little deeper. But again, I don't know what the rest of the folks here, what the consensus would be. So, Mr. Mayor, I don't know how appropriate that is. But.
Well, I think I'm in the position, first of all, this is the only area where we talk about making money. We don't make money off police department, even if they have to spend 30,000 hours in overtime. We don't make any money off police department. We don't make any money off fire department based on the number of runs that they make. Certain things in a community is expected to be there, and most cases it's a situation to where no money is made. We're a service industry. And we can look at every dollar that is spent in the city of Bowling Green and probably ask if we could do something better. But we're in the service business. Service business. I would like and this is just Joe Denning speaking, for the city manager at some point to come back to us based on he and his staff, working with the Parks and Rec Board with a recommendation. Will they get requests, RFPs, whether they don't?
I can tell you right now, it's all depending on whether you think that we should privatize golf. That's a central, seminal issue to be decided. It's not a city manager issue. It's a policy issue. Do you want to be do you want one of your golf courses to be privatized?
My question after that would be, what are we going to determine that is a good thing to do? I think Bruce asked for some financial information.
He wants to know how much it costs to play tennis. I can tell you all the answer to his question is this is the only one that brings in the most leveraged money. Golf brings in the opposite side of Slim's answer is golf brings in the most leveraged money. Not soccer, not baseball, but I can give you all those figures. It'll take us a long time. For example, if you want a total cost of what it costs to play baseball, I got to figure out how do we divide that guy who's cutting grass into five different locations, some of which may not be baseball. It takes that's not an easy question. You can do it with golf and why you can do it with swimming, they're enterprise funds. Everything else is co-mingled together. That's why I brought up about Riverview. This is going to take more thoughtful discussion. We have pending the thing about doing the greens. We need greens done at Riverview. Or we might as well get out of the business because those greens are at the point where it's essentially unplayable. On three or four of the holes.
But we've only had proposals pertaining to greens that even before Mr. Garrett got involved, the proposal to us was for the greens at Paul Walker, not at Hobson. Why didn't the proposal, if we need greens, come from Hobson first, from our own staff, before Mr. Garrett got involved?
Because of cost. Because you need them at both. And Mr. Gary is offering, here's what will happen. If we do the greens at Paul Walker, we will invest, hold on, I'll tell you. $111,000, which Greg Gary is going to tear up the day he gets in there. Do you want us to invest $110,000 of city money with him privatizing and tearing it out and putting his own greens in? I mean, there's not much to study there.
Well, that's only if you lease it and you do your work. If you lease it before you do your work, you don't spend the $111,000.
Right. That's what we're. But that's the issue here is, yeah. Do we move forward with spending $111,000?
Right.
With the potential that.
I mean, I would hope that you would make it.
I would hope we would too. I think that the issue, if I heard it correctly, is when do we get on the schedule? If we wait until February or March and make a decision, or even January and make a decision and then try to get on the schedule of the people who are going to do the work on the greens, can we do them June or before?
If we wait till November 1st, we'll be out of the loop.
That's the issue.
All right. What says the commission? Kevin says that the decision is privatization or not. That is the question right here now before us. So you want an answer right now?
I can give you more information that you're going to spend in a 10-year period X amount of money. Bob is this telling you because it's a public operation, we're going to spend more for this golf course. Period. Now, do we believe enough in Paul Walker that we want to make it private? And then do you want to make it private with little or no control? The issue that Mr. D brought up about us creating a competitor, it's using our asset to create a competitor that's going to hurt our business. We allow our asset to be used to hurt our business if we don't control the rates. Rates are critical to this deal. It's not necessarily a percentage of thing. We have to look at the rates and make sure that there isn't rate manipulation so that no one plays at us, our place.
I guess the question is, do we want to privatize or not privatize?
Let me go first.
Yeah,
go. My answer based, Mr. D.
I just want to say,
go ahead.
I just want to make sure it's clear that the Parks Board understands and recognizes and recommends to you as representative of the citizens on the issue of do we privatize or stay public. Greg Gary's goal as a private entrepreneur is to make money, period. Sure. He's a good businessman. That's his goal. That's what he's supposed to be doing. The Parks Board, our goal for Parks and Recreation is a service. The service is going to cost some money. I think the question you have to ask yourselves, do we want to make money or provide a service? If you want to make money, give it away. If you want to provide a service, leave it as it is.
That, John, I think is, do we want to be good stewards of our taxpayers' money?
And you are, by deliberating on this.
Yeah, and I understand, but the idea of that we want to go out there and we want to make $250,000 a year is not, I don't think, the issue. It's the issue, do we want to make sure that we're spending the money as wisely as we could be?
Absolutely. Yeah. And invest in that service.
Yeah.
I agree.
But I do agree with your two ideas of privatization or service. Yeah.
Right.
With my proposal, I feel like I'm offering both. I feel like I'm offering the money and the service. The course will stay public. The product will be as good or better. The service will be as good or better. And I mean, I feel confident enough in this project that it can be successful not only for me, but for the city. And it's not a thing that you all are turning loose of something just for the money. The service will still be there. Instead of you all seeing the budget figures every month, I'll be seeing them. And, you know, but you will not lose any of the service aspect to the community at all.
Do you have some?
I don't see any way to thoughtfully entertain unless your answer is no, we do not want to privatize. You want to continue to study this, us write our own RFP, legally advertise. A casualty of that is putting in the greens at Paul Walker. That's obvious. There's no way by November 1st you can legally advertise that, all these answers, and have an agreement negotiated. It took 7 weeks to go from the time it was talked about to a meeting with a recommendation. That's just a one-page letter. Imagine an agreement. So the casualty will be the greens at Paul Walker. If you're okay with that, that's fine, because we can get on the schedule in the following year. Bob just said that the greens were probably in the best shape they've been in a long time, Paul Walker, right? So that's the casualty. If we need more time,
with that, weren't we in later years going to redo the greens at Riverview? Wasn't that projected out?
We only have a certain amount of money on the recommendation because of Paul Walker. It's a better golf course. We wanted to make it far superior and improve the greens there. But yes, the intent was that someday to improve the greens at Riverview.
It seems like we're split here. I don't want us to lose a year. I think greens at one of the courses need to be done this year. So if the commission, I would be willing to see the money go to Riverview so we can get on the schedule for this year, since I think we're split on this issue, so we don't lose time.
And I think it has merit that we have to understand we're going to have to dump a whole lot more money into the budget, because we're talking about if I can use an analogy of my hands, we're talking about a cost for Paul Walker here, and we're talking about a cost. I mean, my limited golf knowledge and experience from growing up in the business, when you start wanting to re-foundation greens, I don't know that right now the taxpayer is going to have the stomach for what that's going to cost. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's less work than what I think it's going to be.
There would be basically $100,000 difference if you wanted to regrass the greens at Riverview versus what money we have for Paul Walker. It would take an additional $95,000. That's the figures that Tony and I put together.
Is that minus the irrigation? The irrigation is in better shape, correct?
Yes, the irrigation system at Riverview Golf Course is adequate to where we wouldn't have to make improvements in order to grow the greens in. We have $50,000 in improvements at Paul Walker. for the irrigation system, theoretically, you could take that 50, subtract it from the 100, and only cost you 50,000. The reality of it is, we've been suffering at Paul Walker Golf Course trying to water the greens and keep bent grass alive, which requires a whole lot more water. We have situations on that golf course to where we turn the sprinklers on manually. That's the only way we can turn them on. And we have to go over there and pull the head and pull it up, and it kind of sits there and does that. So actually, the irrigation improvements at Walker need to happen irregardless. We've lived with it for 22 years since I've been here. We can live with it for a little while longer. So the reality of it is, it, you know, if you want to do it right, it would cost you an additional $95,000 at Riverview. We would like to continue to make the irrigation improvements at Paul Walker because it's needed irregardless.
Is the question still, do we have consensus to move forward with further study? And again, I'm not saying go out for an RFP. I'm saying develop and see if that's something we agree with. Do we have consensus to do that, or do we have a consensus to just drop it right now? Seems like...
The way I understood Kevin's concern was that we need to make a decision whether or not we want it to go private or stay as it is.
In the end, that you have more time if you do not do the greens at Paul Walker this year. What I'd like to do is answer Bruce's questions, because I think it has validity all across the board for all our programs. It's something we need to have a budget time.
So that means if you do that, then we can't do anything with the greens right now?
Yes, I don't think it's possible to do something with the greens. Now, if you're going to do something with the greens, and then are you setting in place a situation for yourself where you're spending $100-some thousand and gave it over to a developer, and took your $110,000 and tore it out?
Well, but I had asked that question earlier, a recommendation from you as to what we should do. Now, the recommendation is that you want more time in order to do certain things, and we...
Here, you tell me, I'm your city manager, you tell me what you all want to do, and I will do anything you want me to do.
Okay.
This is what I need to know from five of you. What do you want me and the staff that works for you to do on this proposal? You have the park board that ruled 7-0 no. Okay, that's one point. You have a factual situation. Do you want to invest $110,000 in greens at Paul Walker, and if you privatize, those will be taken out and essentially wasted? Okay. Or do you want to look at the possibility of investing money in the greens at Riverview, figuring that we're going to keep Riverview anyway, but it's going to cost you a little more money? There's no answers today to all these technical questions. What needs to be done, if you want to privatize, you need to go out and publicly say to everybody, look, here's our asset. Give us a proposal how you would like to use it for our benefit and your benefit. We haven't done that. We've never asked anybody to give a proposal how to use our asset. And it is an asset that has value. It shouldn't be just given away. We should have protections for not only what happens if this enterprise fails. Do we have any indemnities that when we get the course back or don't get the course back? What would that value be in 10 years if this enterprise doesn't work? How are we going to adjudicate the division between a neighborhood park and a private golf course? These are all issues that need to be thoughtfully discussed, and not just the result of a one-page letter from one individual. If you're interested in that, we need time to do that. That's what I'll do anything you want. I don't know the answer here. I'll do anything you want.
Billy?
And I think what I've said is I don't know. I obviously appreciate the work of the board, but until I have more information, I I don't know if I want to privatize it or not. I can't sit here today and say that I do, but I obviously can't sit here today and say that I can.
What I'd like
but
to
I may be in the, I'm sorry, Kevin, but I may be in the minority in that decision. The other four may want to just not do any of that.
Here's what I like to do. I like to put together your information that both Bruce and you asked, point one. Point two, we need to put together the framework of a possible RFP and bring it to you. If we had an RFP, it would have these elements. Are you okay with these elements? Three, if you're okay with the elements, then we proceed to advertise legally, as we should, that we have this asset available and that we are asking for Mr. Gary or anyone else who might want to respond. Again, it's impossible to do that by November 1st and Bob has to order up Paul Walker Greens.
What's in Bentgrass or what's
Bermuda. That's the casualty. That's.
I want more information, but I also don't want us to lose out on an entire year for either one of our golf courses. I want one of them to get some improvements this year. So what do we need to do, Kevin, to get one of the golf courses to get them improved? I agree. I don't want to spend a bunch of money.
Yeah, 110, and then you lose it the very
bid day. I don't want to do that. Yeah. So what can we do? So one of the courses, if it's Riverview, great. So they benefit, so we don't lose out a year.
I've been personally studying Riverview for 5 years, thinking that we should sell that. I don't think it's in a condition to have much market value. We have still have a debt on it. We have a new facility, a new clubhouse. It's probably the most orphaned and least advertised of our golf facilities and needs greens done. If you want to achieve your goal of putting money into the greens, the proper place would be to put them in Riverview now and get that on the list. Is that possible, Bob, with our guy? Then it gives us real thoughtful time to put together a sample RFP that has A through E of what we think is important. And that, you just heard from Ernie and I, the issue of a percentage is not that critical to us. What is the other issue is what do you do about it? How do you get it back? How do you protect the asset, the level of insurability, price controls over rates, those kind of things. That's what is concerned. I know we're all frustrated by it because it's not an easy issue. It's like a multi-headed tentacle. On one hand, you have the illusion of saving all this money, but then again, that's not the only issue here.
Any other?
On board with Mr. DeFebo.
Do what? I can't hear.
I'm on board with what Mr. DeFebo said.
So he's going to do some background and going to look at during the work at Hobson. Is that what you're talking about?
Riverview.
Riverview.
A couple months ago, Slim asked us to find some funds for the museum. We think we could find a differential here.
So if you do that, does that mean we're going to come back at some point in time to Walker? Or Walker over?
I would like to order up that we do Riverview Greens now. That satisfies our intent to invest. Then we need more time to write in a sample RFP that we will sunshine to you with the following elements that we can all agree are important. The same thing we did with selling the racetrack, the running shoe person. That just didn't come out anywhere. Then we bring it back and Mr. Gary can look at it and say, this is unworkable. Oh, this is all right.
Okay, what, both of you, okay, same?
I'm fine with the plan. I can tell you based upon my previous knowledge prior to being elected to the commission and based upon what the Parks Board has said, I'm not interested in proceeding. I'm going to be the minority here. I think we're going to lose another year's worth of revenue that potentially could increase at Paul Walker. I think we're going to take an absolute asset to the area over there. Not that it wouldn't be an asset under Mr. Gary, but by putting it off another year, we're going to lessen the asset that we have. And ultimately, if we go out and privatize one of our courses and not all of them, we're creating competition against ourselves. And I don't care if you're in government or if you're in the private sector, but that is a bad business model. It's a bad business model.
So you're saying for the city manager to go on and let's do the work at Walker?
That's exactly right.
At Walker?
That's exactly right. Not interested in proceeding with privatization of the golf course.
And I'm with Slim. So there's your information. Okay, 3-2.
3-2? Is that?
Yeah. And it's certainly, I talked with Greg Gary way before this even came to this room. Greg is my friend, and it has nothing to do with Greg. Nothing whatsoever. We've been friends ever since he was in high school. His dad is one of my best friends in the world. If Greg Gary takes it on, he could do wonders with it. But I just have a problem of giving up a city asset and we being in the service business. What's next? Are we going to have someone, and this is no reflection, but are we going to have someone come in and bid on the police department and so they're going to save us some money and so on? We're in the service industry. I know some of the things we do, we wish we could make money on it, but it's a lot of things we do and we don't make money on it. And like I said, if anybody hears anything that I'm saying, it's nothing against Greg Gary, nothing whatsoever. Greg Gary can do whatever he wants to, whenever he wants to, and I guarantee he's going to make money during it because he does it right. But that's me. Any other?
So it's 3-2 for us to proceed with a sample RFP with the elements that we think should be discussed. 2 is to ask Bob and Tony to talk to our consultant to move the priority from Paul Walker to Riverview Hobson. And 3, I'm going to work with Kate and Jeff Meisel when everybody gets back from school break, and we'll start breaking out the costs for all the various services we provide in Park and Rec. But that will take some time because it is. How do you divide grass cutting around all these facilities? If we're looking at labor, that's an easy question.
Dr. Little, come to the mic, please.
Thank you, because I'm very opinionated in this. I taught at Weston for 31 years, full-time, 5 years part-time. I saw them go through privatization. I never saw them privatize their main mission, which is teaching. By housekeeping, gardening, or landscaping, and everything else, yes. But when it comes to teaching, you've got to be credentialed to be able to do the job as Weston wants it done. Mr. Waldrop, same thing with police officers. You would not want police officers coming in because they had played cowboys and Indians or police at an earlier time and say, I can do this and I can do it good. And this is no reflection on him. And you would not want them to come in and be privatized unless they had been through school, knew the philosophy, knew the background, knew what they were trying to do, knowing child development in the case of recreation. I think this goes much deeper. And I think if we open up privatization of one golf course, where's it going to stop? It could go into anything in recreation. It could go into anything in any other department. And you'll be facing the same question that you're looking at now. I think you never, one, give up facilities. You never, two, take the main mission that you have and delegate it to somebody else to do in your place when you're professionally trained to do it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lilly. Any other? John.
One last thing, and I promise that's it. I wanted to add this. In a sort of a sense, I'm seeing the cart get before the horse. You're looking at a project and trying to decide on whether to do this project without knowing what your philosophy is. And I think collectively you need to decide as a commission, what are we going to be? A service commission as far as our parks is concerned, or a private enterprise commission? Because once you do it with this golf course, there's going to be other elements of recreation that people are going to come along. I can do this with Riverview. I can do this with Crosswinds. You open up a can of worms. You do it for one, got to do it for everybody. So I think you need to collectively decide, do we want our parks department to be service or profit? And then make your decision whether you want to go forward with something like this. Because this is, making your decision on his proposal means you're going to let that proposal govern your philosophy. And you need to decide your philosophy.
But John, and I respect obviously you and what you say, but until we have all the information, I don't know how I can make that decision to move forward if I don't have all the information. I believe I'm sitting here, and what the doctor said was obviously it resonated as well, but I still don't think I can make a decision based upon what we have right now. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking, and I'm not considering making money, and we still are a service industry. That's 70% of our budget's personnel. We provide services, mm-hmm. so to speak. But I'm saying that if we don't take a very diligent look at this, then I'm not sure that those folks that elected me to look at the overall picture, I'm not sure they would be getting what they expected of me. And I'm saying I just need more information. I am not saying I'm for privatization.
Right.
In any way, shape, or form right now. I'm saying I don't know. And I know, Bob, this is causes all kinds of problems, but it's almost like I'm not going to buy the used car today. You got to buy it before I leave the lot, and I'm not going to do that. And in my way of thinking, I just need more information. And again, I may side with privatization is not something once we look at all the issues in RFP. But I'm saying I believe I have to keep my mind open until I have as much information as we can. We're criticized all the time, John, for moving too quickly, moving too slowly. I don't know what the answer is. I'm just saying I need more information, and I think what we've told the city manager is probably the best route. Is it the perfect route? Obviously not, but it seems to me to be the best route.
And you're being a good steward of the taxpayer's dollars by asking for information. I'm just saying before you make your decision on this, decide what your philosophy is. Get your information. Good idea. You're doing the right thing. But then decide what your philosophy is. And Parks Board, you know our philosophy, yeah. Service.
And I don't have I think you're exactly right. Okay. I think we're
right
on. From going out of the, we're not in the same library, I think we're on the same page.
We are. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Any other? No further discussion? Meeting adjourned.